It's an honor and a privilege to be here at Small Farm Conference here in Indiana. That's a really neat thing. It's not many audiences that I speak to where people are routinely on a first name basis with their food. So but this is fun. I live in Hagerstown, Indiana, and which is about an hour east of Indianapolis. For those of you that don't know where Hagerstown is, it's kind of in the middle between Jacksonburg and Millville, so I hope that helps a little bit. I have this funky chair I'm going to use where I can stand up, and it allows me to be out standing in my field sometimes, but I got to learn the technology. If you want the shameless self-promotion part of my talk, is to go to my website, eatmorestrawberries.com. And you can also join our Facebook group from there too. So lots of stuff going on there. And when I have lived on my farm really all my life, almost, my parents bought the farm in 69. I was 7 years old, and I've lived on the same place since I was 7 years old. And the old family joke is, if you stay home long enough, your parents will leave. And that was kind of, I used that a lot. That used to be funny until my daughter enrolled in the ag school at Purdue. And now I'm thinking that joke's going to come back and bite me. I've lived there in the early years, I was raising hogs and corn and soybeans. It's a small farm. It's a 72-acre farm. It's kind of rolly clay ground. If you mashed it all flat, it'd be more like 75 acres. But I used to raise pigs outside on dirt lots. And people, every once in a while, they'll ask me, "Hey, Ed, are you working hard?" And I'm like, "No, I have worked hard. And this is not, whatever I'm doing now, I wouldn't call hard work." This was hard work back in these days. This picture was taken in 1979. It's actually the last photograph in the Hagerstown High School 1979 yearbook. So, and that's me out standing in my field. So I overhauled this tractor in shop class. I split it in two, put new pistons and sleeves and a clutch in it. And it's like, wow, it was just a different world for me, a different life a long time ago. My life got interrupted on September 5th of 1982. This was not part of my business plan. My wife, Debbie, she's back here in the back with me today. We were dating at the time. Long story short, I'm not really here to give this talk today. That's a talk for another day. But we were dating at the time. We'd been dating about 6 months, and we had a jealous ex-boyfriend try to kill us. That's just the short story of it. I survived a violent crime attack. Deb wasn't hurt. This fella, he was arrested and went to trial, went to jail, went to prison. He served his time. He has since been released and hasn't bothered us. And we kind of consider that chapter in our life closed. But as a result of that, I was shot and paralyzed. I was shot with a .44 caliber hollow point in my neck. And it really wiped out a couple of my vertebrae and left me paralyzed completely from, from time to time people will say, "Well, he's paralyzed from the waist down." And I'm like, "Wow, I would love to be just paralyzed from the waist down. You're giving me too much credit because I don't have this back and stomach muscles. That's kind of why I wobble around so much. I'm paralyzed from about the collarbones down. Everything I do is with my arms and my neck muscles. And what little bit of my brain that I have. I'm kind of like the scarecrow some days. When I was in this picture, I was 21 years old, 82, 83. I come home to a farm. We had Scotch collies and almost 1,000 pigs on dirt lots. And I'm like, "What in the world am I going to do?" I'm sitting in a stainless steel basketball wheelchair. I got to reinvent my life here. I was the most disabled person I knew in my town. I had lots of help, though. You know, I was blessed to be surrounded by family, friends, and neighbors who cared. You know, typical Indiana experience on a farm, the neighbors all came out and harvested my crops that fall. Of course, they'll do that once. They won't do that every year. You know, they're wanting you to figure out what you're going to do. They'll give you a helping hand up. You know, we slowly started swapping the equipment around, and I could get equipment that was more accessible for me. In fact, it wasn't so much for me to go back to work as it was initially just maybe some good therapy for me. But it developed into work, and I realized, you know, once I'm on a tractor, I could be as productive as the next guy. I just had to think the job a little differently. But we slowly started working out of pigs. And in 1985, my wife and I started planting strawberries for the first time. Why strawberries? Well, it's because my grandpa years ago used to say, find a niche and fill it. And nobody was really raising strawberries in my area. And I figured I could be a total failure at it and maybe still succeed. So the last thing I wanted to do was compete with somebody who could walk. So I wanted to raise a crop that nobody else was raising so I could be a total mess up at it and then maybe still have a chance at succeeding. Deb and I have been doing this a long time. Excuse me. We've been, you know, like I said, we raised strawberries since 85. We were married in 83. We had went 9 years to have my daughter. Actually, because of the disability, we didn't think we were going to be able to have kids. But you know, we practiced a lot, but figured we were wasting our time. But about 9 years into our marriage, she had went to the doctor with a head cold that ended up having a heartbeat, and we were pretty excited about that. But this is my daughter Nellie. And I'm going to share a couple of family slides here because I want you to understand part of this on the farming is philosophy for me. So it's not just about what we produce and what we sell and our financial bottom line. Why am I even farming? Well, one, it's because it's something I can do. You know, there's a lot of jobs with my particular physical limitations I can't do. And farming is something, as a self-employed person, I had that knowledge and experience in my heart and in my head before my injury. I just needed to modify the farm to me. And operate programs like Breaking New Ground and AgriBuildy, they got a booth back in the exhibit hall, have helped me with solutions to be able to eliminate barriers. But being able to do it is one of the reasons. The other, and being wanting to do it is another reason. And then thirdly, it's because it's a lifestyle that's important to my wife and I. It was an important lifestyle to my parents. I wasn't raised in the country by accident. My father was a police officer in Richmond for many years, and when I was born, he moved to Hagerstown to raise me on a farm because he said he had arrested too many people in Richmond. So, instead of spending my days as a little boy riding a bike in a city, I spent my days with a dog down in the creek and learning to farm next to my dad doing chores and how to work. And Deb and I wanted to raise our daughter the same way. So really I'll start off with the crops that we raise on our farm. As the number one most important crop was our daughter Nellie. You know what? Nothing else matters. I don't really care how many Canadian thistles are in my strawberry. Well, I care, but I don't care about the Canadian thistle in my strawberry near as much about the weeds that would be in her life. So this is a primary focus. So with our family, we have this little motto. I don't know if we have it written down, but we kind of practice it. And this is in priority. It's really faith, family, friends, and then farm. All those things are important, but we try to keep those in perspective. When we get those out of priority, faith, family, friends, and farm, when we get those out of priority, then we start having problems popping up in the way we operate our farm. So far as the family end of it, we homeschooled my daughter. We're pretty proud of that. She has been raised with strawberries. The poor kid had no choice but to have strawberry dresses and strawberry this and strawberry that. She is a sophomore at Purdue now, studying ag business management, ag marketing. She was a FFA state officer a couple years ago. Our family is what we call ourselves, real FFA nerds. So any of you have young people, boy, we just encourage them to get involved in FFA. It's a great program. It'll really help develop character and push them out of their comfort zones. And the blue corduroy jacket took my daughter places that she never dreamed of going. So we highly recommend that. That's a great agricultural program. But we do raise strawberries. You go to eatmorestrawberries.com. You can learn more about what we're doing. I'm going to sit down here because I kind of like to move around when I'm talking a little bit. We have about 7 acres of strawberries on any given year. Last year we had 9. It's kind of subjective because the way we plant, it's a perennial and we're always rotating around. But if you go a mile west of Hagerstown, Indiana, you'll find our little farm. We're setting up on a hill. We had a old farmhouse that I was raised in. It was built pre-1822. My wife and I had a house fire in 95, so we've got a newer house that's more accessible to me, but we survived our house fire. That was an eventful night, and that's another talk for another day, but we switched from raising Scotch Collies to Dobermans because of the violent crime experience and the future parole and all that. We just thought maybe Dobermans would be a better dog, but we ended up falling in love with the breed. But one of my very first Dobermans was with me in the house when the house was on fire, and the accessible entrance was in flames because of the way the wind was blowing, and we were home. It was in the evening, and my wife took my daughter at that time. She was 3 years old, my daughter Nellie, and she picked up my daughter and started closing doors and came in. I had just got off the tractor and laid down for the day, and she opened the bedroom window and looked at me like, this is not a drill. We had kind of practiced this emergency plan, and she took my daughter and went outside, and I'm in there with my Doberman, and I get in my chair, and when your house is on fire, you make a lot of decisions like, wow, do I really need underwear right now, it's a personal choice, but for me the answer was no. So I just put on a pair of pants and got out, but I had to go out an entrance that was not accessible. There weren't even any steps. It was an old door, an old farmhouse that we didn't use, and she was able to get it open, and I got in the doorway, and it's a 3-foot drop off, so I was like, well, I'll scoot out of my chair, and then I was a manual chair those days. She was going to pull the manual chair out over my shoulders, and then I'd transfer into it. And while I'm transferring out, my big Doberman about knocked me out of the doorway, jumping over my shoulder and jumping out in the yard. And I'm like, well, so much for Lassie, go help Timmy out of the well. I can tell where your allegiance is there, buddy. So he was cheering me on, though, once I was in the yard. But we raise strawberries that other than my daughter and family and friends, which are really the most important part of our farming operation. The commercial side, the mercenary side of our farm is strawberries, asparagus, and now Doberman puppies. We kind of stumbled into Doberman puppies, so I'll talk about that. I use a lot of technology on the farm to do what I do. I have this wheelchair that lets me stand. I started using a wheelchair 30 years ago when I was 21, and technology has changed a lot. I pushed a manual wheelchair for 11 years on an Indiana farm with gravel driveways. Of course, as W.C. Fields says, youth is wasted on the young. But I started using an electric wheelchair because it just makes more sense. You know, there's a time and a place for a handsaw and a time and a place for a power saw, and I'm trying to make a living and trying to raise a family, and this is just a tool to help me do what I do. Occasionally somebody will make the remark or I'll see it in print in an article or something, you know, that Ed's confined to a wheelchair, and I'm like, you know, I'm not caught up in political correctness, and don't get me wrong, it doesn't offend me. But I always chuckle a little bit because I think, nah, my wheelchair doesn't really confine me, it liberates me. Because if you want to see me confined, get me out of my wheelchair. I'm just kind of crawling around on my elbows. Then I got problems. Without my wheelchair, I'm cranky. Ask my wife. She can tell you. I got to have my stuff working. You know, it helps me do what I do. But this is just a tool to help me do what I do. I started using a standing chair about 10 years ago, and prior to that, I sat for 20 years. So picture yourself on that long car ride when you go on vacation and how good it feels to stand up when you get out at the rest stop, and then multiply it by a couple decades and you're not even close to where I was. So this is an amazing machine. I mean, I can actually change light bulbs in a couple of the rooms of my home now, do things I never dreamed of doing, let alone the health benefits from it. In fact, I have an off-farm job in the wintertime just to help support my ag habit. And I work as a consultant for lots of different folks, but one of the projects that I do consulting for is the standing company. So in addition, I have, you know, high-tech, low-tech technology, with some things we've just kind of developed on our own and acquired. And let me get down here and I can point off. This is my little one-row tractor that I use. Actually, this tractor was made the year I graduated in high school. It's a great little tractor. I'm kind of colorblind on the type of equipment I have, as long as it runs. But there's some things I do different than the average guy. One is if you notice the hoe handle here, that's a broken hoe handle. You would be amazed if you just followed me. Not that I'm amazing. What I do's may be amazing, but if you come out in my farm in the summertime and followed me around when I'm working in the farm, you would be amazed what I can do with a little tractor and a broken hoe handle, because I just can't hop off and do things. But, you know, with the broken hoe handle, I move irrigation pipe, and it's just, once in a while I come in the house. You know, I'm 52 years old, and I come in the house, and my wife's like, well, how'd you do that? And I was like, I just kind of figured it out. And, you know, it's frustrating sometimes, and some of you may think, wow, I couldn't do that. Well, if you had no other choice, you would, or give up. You know, one of my big motivations in doing the things that I do is, even if it's a stinky job that wasn't fun and was very frustrating, one of my ultimate motivations is, well, you know, it beats rotting in a nursing home. Hey, I had a pretty good day. You know, you got to think about it that way. My wife and I, we use other tools to help keep us motivated, even though maybe the road that we roll or crawl on is a little steep sometimes. We have problems just like anybody else. I mean, we've got financial issues on the farm, just like you folks do. Wow, last year we had some weather problems. I bet nobody else in the room had weather problems. We had the same weather problems you guys do. We have, even she and I will disagree sometimes. Because, you know, guys, I'm only talking to guys right now, okay? How many of you are married? Married guys? Okay. All right, I'm just talking to you guys. You young guys maybe that want to get married someday, you can listen. I've been married 30 years this year, okay? Here's a little bit of advice. A man should always get in the last two words, all right? Now, you ladies, this isn't for you. Now, guys, yeah, you hear that? Okay, well, hold on. The last two words should always be yes, dear, okay? There are some... There's some optionals like I'm sorry, you're right, I'm wrong, those combinations, but a man should always get in the last two words. But we have to learn to do with what we have. And my dad taught me a long time ago. He said, you know, when you see the big old trees in a farm field, a farmer wants to get rid of that tree because it's in the way, it's shade, and you're trying to plow the field. He says, hey, the old guys in the days of horses, they would cut that tree down and then they'd have this stump in the way. Well, then they would try to pull the stump out, and sometimes the tree was too big for that, or the stump was too big. So then they would try to dig it out, and sometimes it was too deep to dig it out. They'd get dynamite back when it was legal and try to blast it out. And so sometimes they couldn't even get the stump out that way. Well, farmers would not let the field go to waste. If they had a stump that was in their way and they couldn't get it out, they would plow around it. And that's what I have learned to do, is when I have a stump that's too big or too deep, I just plow around it. And so that's what I do. There's a piece of rebar that's been fastened onto my pedals. That's for my hand clutch, and I have the hand brake on the other side there. It's kind of hard to see, but there's a backpack hanging on the back of the tractor, and then here on the foot deck, it's just full. It's a little dark, but there's all kinds of stuff sitting on the foot deck. Foot space isn't real high priority for me. I don't really need the foot space, so I put everything on the foot decks and in the backpack, because I can't just top off and go, oh, I need a 9/16 inch wrench. Hey, Deb, can you bring me a 9/16 wrench? I've never done that to you, have I? No, yeah, I'm sorry, but you're lying right now, okay? I got to call you on that. But I have to carry things with me. And I've learned I don't just carry one 9/16 with me. I carry two or three, because if I drop one, I'm like, great. I can't just hop off and get it. So, in fact, I got one of those little magnetic reacher things so I can, you know, maybe salvage the day. I do things differently. It's not just the tools, but I do things differently. This is a little cart that I've put an air compressor with a hose reel and a generator, and you see the impact wrenches. I can't always just get the equipment up where I want it, but I can take this cart most of the times and get it to where I'm gonna be working on something. I use a lot of like pneumatic tools because I don't have the back and the stomach and the leg muscles. It's amazing how much we use our back muscles and our leg muscles when we're doing stuff. I don't have pictures of this, but I'll use a lot of oversized tools like breaker bars and big wrenches and big socket. I got a big 3/4 inch socket set. So because I don't have the muscles, I use the leverage. I'll put a big cheater bar on a big ratchet wrench to break things loose and tighten it. I always get a chuckle when I got my buddy Wally comes over to help me out occasionally. And you know, he'll be working on a bolt and he'll like, gee, who put this on? I'm like, I did, you know. But I didn't tell him I had a 6-foot breaker bar on the end of it. So yeah, I do all kinds of stuff. Deb helps me. I have employees that help me from time to time. I'll talk about employees here in a second, but I rearranged my work. I have to think about, okay, since I can't walk, how can I do this smarter? How can I do this where a way that I can handle it? I lay all the irrigation pipe. I do that myself. I've got aisleways on the edges of my field, and I've got another chair that I use that never sees a sidewalk. I hose it off maybe twice a year. It works fine. It's just too ugly to bring into a place like this. It's like my work shoes. But I lay all the irrigation pipe and snap it. Used to have my wife and daughter help me lay the pipe, but they complained too much, and I got tired of listening to it. So I figured out a way to lay that pipe myself. Actually, my goal is to be less of a burden to them. So I'm trying to figure out how I can always do things more myself so I don't bother them and I can get more things done. Every little bit I do is that much they don't have to do. So I do all the pipe now. We use this rubber hose now to what we used to do was run the pipe through the field, and my wife and daughter would have to carry it through the rows. I learned that I can lay the pipe in the aisleway and then just hook it up with this rubber hose, so they don't have to do it now. And now they still whine. I'm sorry, it's just true. They still whine and complain because I have to have help hooking up the hard hose traveler, taking it in and out of the fields. That's a two-man job. But they don't have to lay pipe, and I frequently remind them that they don't have to lay pipe anymore. So there's lots of things that I do differently. The title of my talk is Farming My Way. So I'm not teaching you how to farm or grow strawberries today. If you came here expecting that, you're going to go away gravely disappointed. I'm just telling you how I farm my way. And because it's my way doesn't mean it's the right way. But with me not walking, I have to do a lot of things differently. One of the things, this is kind of a high-tech solution, I use a lift on my tractor. This one's actually made in Indiana, Brookston, Indiana, Life Essentials. I transfer out of my chair onto the tractor lift, and it lifts me up considerably high where I can get, not only on and off my tractor, but anything I can drive up next to, I can get on and off of, or I can reach. If we have a floodlight burnout on the porch, I can replace it so Deb doesn't have to now. But it has a seat belt, and it's pretty safe. Makes a good deer stand, too. So, and then once I'm on the tractor, I kind of fold that out of the way, and off I go. You can see I have hand controls here, and the canopy, because I don't do real well in the hot sun because of the disability and so on. When I get up in the morning, this is my greeting party. We have, 9 or 10 Dobermans? 9, 10? These are our adult dogs. We don't have a kennel. They're not kennel dogs. These are family members, but they're on invisible fence. They have the run of the farm on the invisible fence. We pin them up and kennel them during our sales season, during strawberries when we got customers and such, but a UPS man just kind of hates me, let's just say. We have a couple litters of puppies a year, and we sell them through our website, eatmorestrawberries.com. We probably get 2 serious contacts a day through emails or phone calls, maybe 3, of people wanting puppies. And we have puppies all over the country. This dog going off the boat dock is in Texas. We don't ship our puppies. People drive to us or sometimes fly to us and rent a car and drive home. We had a gentleman in the last litter fly in from Colorado and pick up a puppy and they let him take it carry-on and fly back to Colorado. I bet that was a fun flight home. But we started off raising puppies so that we got the Dobermans because of security, and then we started raising puppies because that process answers a lot of fact-of-life questions for my daughter when she was little. So, you know, seeing how puppies are made and how they're born and how they're raised and so on. So, but it just kind of grew, and it's almost really like, even though they're family members and pets, so it's like a livestock operation. So we raise asparagus. We have an acre of asparagus. Don't make a lot of money on asparagus, but it helps us have a little cash flow early in the spring when we're short of money. Asparagus starts usually around tax day. After we've paid Uncle Sam, we have a little cash flow starting to come in. And then it also gives workers. We work with seasonal workers sometimes, and it creates jobs for them for grocery money so they don't get frustrated and take off. We have to cut asparagus every day, at a minimum every other day, depending on weather. It usually starts when the soil's warm, about 50 degrees, acre of it, and we sell it local there on the farm. Everything we raise on our farm's retail. I sell a little wholesale once in a while, but personally, I just rather let it rot in the field than to give it away. My goal when I started into alternative agriculture was, I thought, you know, I could raise corn and soybeans and pigs like I used to, and I do all my work, and I say at the end of my day, I say I have to go to somebody and take my hat off and say, how much will you give me for all this? But with the retail, people come to me and they say, well, how much is your crop? And unless they walk away, I get to set the price. So I want to set the price. Everything's retail. Sell our asparagus. We live on a state highway in between two county seats. We're 5 miles off of interstate. And people come on the honor system and buy our asparagus. Asparagus is getting it established is expensive, takes a long time, about 3 years before you can really pick it, and then you got to limit the time that you pick it. But once it's established, it'll outlive you and me. It's a perennial, it's a massive crop with a big, massive root system. It's a perennial, comes back year after year. And you cut it for about 8 weeks. Once it's mature, it comes right back up, you cut it again. And then as far as cultural practices, it really wouldn't be a hard crop to graze organically. I'm not an organic farmer, but I am what I consider a low input. You're going to see weeds and bugs on my farm. It's not going to be a sterile environment because I'm very low input. Asparagus is a low input crop. They do like to eat, but I'll kind of cover how we do that. Strawberries, as I said, we have about 6-7 acres of strawberries. Last year we had 9. Of all years with the drought, we had 9, imagine. The crop adjuster, I think, was the only job worse in agriculture last year than to be a farmer. The strawberries is... We used to sell about half and half you pick and already picked, everything retail on my farm. On any given day in June, on a nice Saturday, sunny day, we might have 1,000 people come through my little driveway, which isn't bad for a little farm. It's fun because Deb's doing sales, my wife's doing sales, my daughter will help with sales, and we got people working for us. And I'm just kind of in the background going around doing jobs before they become problems. It might be folding boxes or making sure where the employees show up and they're picking right and all this. And I'm just kind of buzzing around. Inevitably, this happens at least once or twice a year. I'll be doing something like sorting berries or folding boxes, and some little old lady will come up and pat me while I'm sitting there in my wheelchair and go, "Isn't it nice these people let you work here?" I just say, "Yes, ma'am," and I take her money. I do all the tillage work with my equipment. My wife doesn't really, she'll help me hitch and unhitch some things, but she really doesn't see much tractor time. I do all the field work myself. It's once in a while Debbie will say, "You know what your problem is? You need some tractor therapy." So, you know, our goal is to make money, but if we can at least just break even, we have to think about how much we saved on psychotherapy at the end of the year. So that's part of what we do. Faith, family, friends, and farm. I have my newer tractor has a loader bucket on it, and boy, that's just really added. When you can't hop on and off a tractor, a loader bucket just becomes an extension of my body. I'll talk a little bit about cultural practices. Town of Hagerstown is a mile away from me, a town about, a little less than 2,000 people. They suck up and grind their leaves in the fall every year. They had a problem of disposing them. I said, "Bring them on out to my farm." In addition to that, some local arborists bring out their wood chips and tree trimmings after they chip them up. And they dump them on my farm, bring them to me for free. And I compost them and let them rot down. And we load this up and put it on my fallow ground where I'm going to plant strawberries, and we also use it to mulch asparagus in the fall. And we spread this rotted leaf mulch, which is what my soil was made of. These are hardwood soils. The soils that we live on were made by hardwoods, you know, centuries after tree, shedding leaves and dropping branches. So I'm just feeding it back to what it was made originally. And boy, does it make a good soil. We spread it on the field. That's not plowed ground. That's not disc ground. That's rotted leaf mulch. And we spread it on about 3 to 4 inches thick. And you want to loosen up a clay loam or a tight clay soil, you put that much leaf mulch on every couple years and plow it under. Boy, you've got something that holds moisture and really, really good. If you can get a hold of it, it's good. Some of you folks that are doing some micro, small plots, it's amazing the amount of money you can raise on a small piece of ground. Use this method, it works really well. And then I'd till it in, and then we plant it. I use local help. I also use some seasonal farm workers. Seasonal farm workers for me is getting harder to find because as the dollar gets worth less, fewer people are coming from Mexico to the United States. So there's more and more competition and fewer seasonal workers. So labor is an ongoing issue. That changes from time to time. That was me planting strawberries, by the way. It's amazing what I can do with a broken hoe handle. There's another one there. I'm marking rows. I'm helping them with that hoe handle fix some of these plants. Two guys riding on the planter, it's like a tobacco setter, and one guy walking behind fixing corrections and skips. This is how I put my mulch on my strawberries. I don't like to tell people that live close to me how I raise strawberries, but I figure maybe I can share this one because you'll think I'm crazy and none of you will probably want to try it, which is fine with me. In fact, I have customers come up to me all the time. They're like, hey, I got a few strawberries. How do I keep the weeds out of my strawberries? He says, what can I spray on it that'll kill the weeds? And I go, well, Roundup. So the smart ones say, well, now, won't that kill my strawberries? Yeah, but then you can come buy them for me, see? So, you mulch strawberries, they're called strawberries because you mulch them with straw so they overwinter. This is how I put my mulch on my strawberries. My straw mulch goes on in August. Normally, you don't put straw mulch on until the ground's froze in November. I mix 5 bushels of oats with my granular fertilizer and I feed them in August. I clean my strawberries up, cultivate subsoil and cultivate them. I go out and spread this on my strawberries in August and then leave them alone and just keep pouring water on them. And I get a companion crop. This is 917 and what my strawberry crop looks like. You can see if I get the right button here, that's the row of strawberries right there. And this is the aisleway. I got oat crop coming up as a companion crop. And then later in October, you drive by my farm and guys are like, Ed's nuts. He's just ruined that farm. What'd you do to your strawberries? You getting out of business? We hear that kind of stuff every year. I got a couple Amish neighbors that kind of tease me, you know, it's like, you need some help getting the weeds out of your crop, Ed? I was like, no, I'm doing that on purpose, you know. I get along with my neighbors really well. They're just kind of joking with me, but this is what my strawberry field looks like in October. It's an oat crop about ready to harvest. And then that'll winter kill down. And then in April, the next year, this is what my crop looks like. So it may not work for you. I hope you don't even try it, frankly. But it works for me. I did this because of necessity. I can't walk and spread straw, and it was getting really cost effective for me to hire people to do it all the time. So, but this is an accessible way to accommodate my disability for my farming operation, and it works well for me. So, in fact, I got an old extension bulletin from 1912 where strawberry growers were actually doing this. That's kind of where I got the idea. Strawberries, you know, they're a June crop, a perennial crop. We try to keep them 3 to 4 years. The main crop, and I got to end it up here pretty quick. The main crop we grow is really people. I mentioned that with my daughter, faith, family, friends, but my customers are really my crop. I'm not a good grower. Don't come to my farm to learn to grow strawberries. I'm really a better marketer. My wife and I both. We invest in people. We cultivate people more than we do the crop, and they pay us for doing that. They're paying us for asparagus, for strawberries, and for Doberman puppies, but they're also paying us for an experience. So we're constantly cultivating people. One of my main jobs is how do I get a driveway full of people when I need them with a very perishable crop. Puppies that are only going to be cute for a little while, asparagus that grows so fast you can pick it almost twice a day, and strawberries that, you know, are only going to last in your cooler overnight. I got to get all these people in my driveway. This lady's 100 years old. She's smiling because she gets free. When you're 100 years old, all your strawberries are free on my farm. And she made it. And she brought 5 generations with her when she came. I cultivated her for over a decade. to achieve this goal. And you guarantee her great-grandkids are always going to come back to me, and she's going to tell her friends and neighbors. The trade magazines will tell you that UPIC is dead. Go into entertainment. Well, it might work for you, but you know what? I think UPIC is alive. It just needs to be cultivated. How do we get young families to experience it? That's my goal. We're constantly looking for ways to get young families to come out and pick their own. When I have plenty of berries, we give people a free quart of strawberries if they'll just go pick some and pay for some when they pick some. I give them a free container so they can visually see how much they're getting for free. Debbie will hand them an empty quart and say, hey, you can have this free if you go pick some. And they'll look at each other like, well, you want to try it? Yeah, we'll go try it. They come walking in with a big flat of strawberries with a face, an expression on their face like, why did we just do that? And then we go, yeah, well, here's your free berries. And we pour it on top. We're not even at the container cost. So, and they come back and they bring their friends. And they go, you got to go with us to pick strawberries. It's so much fun. And we're like, yeah, but don't the little kids step on them? Yeah, they're paying for that. That's why I grow so many. Don't they eat them when they're out there picking? Yeah, I'm not producing strawberries so much as I'm cultivating people. That's why I grow so many, so they can pay for that experience. I got to keep moving here. We haul them in and out of the field. We take them clear to the farthest end of a strawberry field and have them pick towards the cash register. That way, when they think they've got enough in their box, they got to walk back through all the strawberries, and they're like, because they're not going to pay attention to the row they're on anyway. They skip all over, and it's very hard to manage people. But there's another one. I got to have that one. And they, by the time they get up to the cash register, they always have a full box, and they're happy. It's a great experience. They give me money. They tell their friends and neighbors, and they Facebook their pictures, and then they come back with a carload of friends. And bottom line is, we want to have fun, and we want to live our faith and love our family and our friends, and then cultivate our farm. So I could go on, but I got to respect your time. I don't think we really have time for questions, so I'll just kind of wrap it up. I'll hang around here if you want to ask me questions later. I'll be here and we can talk. So, but I appreciate your patience and your attention. I thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.